Your phone is more powerful than the onboard computer of the Apollo missions that took humans to the moon. And I'm not even exaggerating, truly. Actually, it's way more powerful. The so-called Apollo guidance computer had just over 4 megabytes of RAM, which stored temporary data, and only 75 kilobytes of ROM, which is the computer's permanent memory. And these numbers seem like a joke if you compare them to any smartphone these days. Doesn't matter how simple it is. And yet, those relatively modest specifications managed to expertly steer a spacecraft to the moon and then bring everyone back to Earth safe and sound without fail. But how in the world can a device possess computing power thousands of times greater in an insanely smaller structure, one that conveniently fits right in your pocket? The answer to that question lies in a tiny object, but one that managed to spark an unprecedented tech revolution. I'm talking about the semiconductor chips. But to really get what these chips are all about, first we gotta grasp what exactly a semiconductor is. You gotta know there are materials that are awesome at conducting electricity. Gold, silver, copper, aluminum are prime examples of that. They've got more free electrons, meaning electrons in the valence shell. This process lets electric charges move through these materials more easily, without running into much resistance. On the flip side, some materials, including glass, rubber, silicone, and ceramics, for instance, are poor at conducting electricity. In these cases, the electrons are really tightly bound to the atom's nucleus, and that's why these substances are insulators. They make it tough for electrical charges to get through. And somewhere in between these two materials, there are those that have a kind of middle-of-the-road electrical conductivity, meaning they can act both as insulators and as conductors, and we call these materials semiconductors. The main semiconductors are silicon and germanium. The electronics industry leans heavily on silicon because it can withstand high temperatures, and also because it's easier to come by in nature, being as plentiful as grains of sand. And it's literally because silicon is extracted right from certain types of sand. This element is so crucial in the production of semiconductor chips that the region in the United States, which is home to the world's leading tech companies in California, is aptly named Silicon Valley. The chips are basically made from a wafer. You know that cookie that has some layers? Just kidding. Actually, in electronics, a wafer is a super thin slice of some semiconductor material that's got microcircuits slapped onto it. And these circuits make up designs, which are patterns that control the flow of electric current through transistors, which are like tiny switches. They turn on and off, allowing or preventing the flow of electric current. So computers are programmed to interpret the flow, or lack thereof, of electric current as either the number 0 or the number 1, which are called bits. It's this sequence of millions of zeros and ones that makes computers run and interpret absolutely everything we can think of, from very simple stuff like texts and photos to extremely complex tasks, like landing on the moon or a TikTok dance video. Actually, these days, semiconductor chips aren't just in computing devices and mobile cell phones. Pretty much all modern products use these parts. Right there, all around you, it is impossible to not find one next to you. You're surrounded by chips. Your chargers, or your TV, your air conditioner, the microwave, the intercontinental ballistic missile for sending atomic bombs, there's no escaping it. Humans have implanted chips in just about everything. But what a lot of folks don't realize is that this technology that's so crucial today actually got its start several decades ago. The first semiconductor chip was whipped up in the 50s, and it had 4 transistors, which means 4 of those tiny switches that control the flow of electricity. Over the years, that number kept climbing. The march of technology enabled creating chips with 8 transistors, then 16, 32, and so on. In the current technological landscape, there are microchip technologies with 114 billion transistors. It's not just thousands, it's not millions actually. It's billions with a B of switches. Each one sending their zeros and ones like crazy on a chip the size of your fingernail. Or a bit bigger, if you've got a habit of biting your nails. To fit so many transistors into such a tiny piece, they gotta be real close to each other. It's a distance that simply can't be measured in inches or millimeters. To make the math easier, we've got to use nanometers, which means 1 meter split into a billion pieces. Just to give you an idea, a strand of hair is about 100,000 nanometers thick. And in the latest chips these days, the distance between transistors is down to 2 nanometers. This is about the size of a strand of DNA. You have to imagine that to build a chip like this, we need cutting-edge technology with ultra-innovative equipment operating in super modern factories. And these factories are so incredibly specialized, they've even got their own distinct names. They're known as FABs. They're highly controlled environments. Indeed, folks working at those spots even gotta wear special gear. That's because even a speck of dust can cause a chip production to go haywire and lead to a massive loss for these factories. And they rely on such advanced tech that only a handful of companies nowadays have the means to produce those kinds of chips. Across the whole planet Earth, the so-called lithography, which is the chip-making process, essentially hinges on two companies, TSMC and ASML. They're probably the most important brands in your everyday life that you've never heard of. The story leading us here started in the US, which was at the forefront of making those chips during the Cold War. Originally, this technology was all about military and space stuff. The chips were mainly sold to the US government. But soon enough, businessmen caught on to the incredible potential of semiconductors and realized that using these chips in personal computers for everyday people could totally change the game and make them a lot of money. The United States then actively strongly encouraged establishing chip factories in eastern countries where the labor was cheaper. But quickly, those countries realized they could start their own companies, and that's exactly what they did. One of those companies was TSMC, the Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company. Founded in the 80s, it's now the biggest chip maker in the world. By the end of 2022, it was dominating 58% of the global market, way ahead of the runner-up, Samsung, which held 16% of the market. With a market value of over $400 billion, TSMC is one of the top 15 most valuable companies in the world. And it's the one making the most advanced chips globally. Likely your phone has a chip made by TSMC, even if you don't know it. This company is so important that it is at the center of a geopolitical crisis between the two biggest global powers, the United States and China. What happened was, Taiwan was part of China, but broke off from Beijing when communist Mao Zedong came to power. Nowadays, this little piece of land that's actually so close to China geographically has a much bigger commercial relationship with the United States. The United States even struck a deal with TSMC to build one of their factories in the US, which is supposed to happen in 2025. The White House also imposed essentially a series of business bans on Chinese companies to try and bolster local manufacturers. Thing is, these sanctions from the US don't just involve American companies, but also those from other countries doing business with China. And among them is that other notable company I just mentioned a little while ago, ASML. The Advanced Semiconductor Materials Lithography is a Dutch company that manufactures the precise machines that fabricate the chips. This is such a niche and cutting-edge operation that no other company in the whole wide world can do what they do. Each lithography machine made by ASML weighs 180 tons and costs several million dollars each. No wonder, it's the fourth most significantly valuable company in all of Europe, with a market value of $250 billion. Turns out, because of the significant threats from the US government, ASML announced a few months back that it has to limit its machine exports to China. All these restrictions have led to a whole bunch of uncertainties about chip production and sales across the globe, ramping up a crisis that was also sparked by other reasons. One of the main reasons was the pandemic. Just like other economic sectors, the whole global lithography scene got hit hard by the virus, since a bunch of factories had to shut down for quite a while. But in this case, the situation was even more dire, because the pandemic was a time when the demand for tech products went through the roof. As folks started spending more time at home, including studying remotely and working from home, there was a sudden spike in the hunt for computers, smartphones, tablets, cameras, and other electronic gadgets, right at a time when manufacturing was precisely getting hit hard because of all the health restrictions. This semiconductor crisis has other reasons too. Even the war between Russia and Ukraine could pose a long-term threat. That's because Ukraine is responsible for about 70% of the global production of neon, which is a gas used in making semiconductor chips. And you know how they say when you're going through a rough patch, everything goes south? Well then, this crisis could worsen by the lack of sand. Like I said at the start of the video, silicon is extracted from a particular type of sand. But its predatory extraction has caused serious damage to the environment, even changing the course of a river in Sri Lanka and causing small islands to disappear. Besides, other natural problems are throwing a wrench in the chip-making process. In recent years, Taiwan has been hit with the worst drought in decades, messing with semiconductor production since the process needs a ton of water. And even a fire at a factory in Japan has caused an interference in the global chip supply. All these factors combined have significant practical consequences, even here in Brazil. Data shows that the country stopped the production of over 600,000 cars because they ran out of chips. Volkswagen, for instance, even had to shut down the assembly line and halt a factory, since the automaker couldn't get its hands on semiconductors. That's because chips aren't just used in electric cars, but actually in pretty much every vehicle that's essentially manufactured these days. They're in the electronic dashboard, power windows, automatic locks, and even when the driver signals a turn. But the damage caused by the chip shortage hits not just the car market. During this current crisis, 73% of electronics companies have been hit by a shortage of components. And to try to keep these issues from happening again, a bunch of countries are pouring money into making their own chips so they don't have to rely so much on this complicated supply chain that involves a whole lot of countries. And that's important not just from the money side of things, but from the science angle too. After all, countries that want to have sovereignty and independence need to invest in technology, and it's a matter that even involves national security. Remember when I said that even rockets that can cross the ocean use these chips? If a country relies solely on another's sophisticated tech to build its own weapons, for example, that essentially means it's completely open to threats from adversary nations. And even in matters that are, or at least should be, significantly more important than wars, investing in this kind of technology is also absolutely crucial. Take healthcare, for example. State-of-the-art medical devices rely heavily on semiconductors. Same deal with the environment. Equipment to monitor deforestation and fires also needs chips to work effectively. Don't even get me started on education. Just picture the role of this technology in remote learning, computing, robotics, and other learning-related activities. Just like in culture, watching movies at home, blasting tunes on a speaker, and even gaming with buddies are all activities made possible thanks to these little gadgets. And I could keep rattling off a bunch of other areas where semiconductor chips are crucial, but you've probably already caught on to how important they are in our everyday lives. I can't even begin to imagine what our lives would be like today without the incredible ability to cram so much processing power and data storage into just a few inches. You definitely wouldn't even be watching this video if it weren't for semiconductors, so take full advantage of the fact that chips let you not just watch but also thoroughly enjoy this video, share it with your buddies, and drop a comment below on what other topics you'd like to see on the channel. Thanks a bunch and see you next time.